I am from upstate New York.
I'm from downstate New York.
I live now in Brighton, England.
And I live in London now.
So how long have you been in the UK?
13 years.
So I've been living here for 10 years, and I've spent a lot of that time working as a physics teacher in secondary schools.
So if you're giving somebody your phone number, your credit card number, and you've got two numbers in a row that are the same, so my number is 8844 in my office. The British way to say that would be 8844. And it would have never occurred to me to say it that way.
I don't know about Americans in general, but I can say that for me, when I moved to London, I was really thrown by the double numbers thing for quite a while.
I would say 8844. I might say 8844, but I wouldn't say 8844.
When I moved here, there were two problems, right? One is the double numbers thing. And the second thing is that people say the telephone numbers in a different pattern than they do U.S. numbers. So it was that different pattern plus people saying things like 5599. I had such a hard time getting those numbers the first time. And maybe I'm just particularly slow.
But the thing that always trips me up is I don't know whether to say triple when I get three of those things in a row. So if I had a credit card that had three zeros in a row, do I say 000? Do I say 000? Do I say 000? Do I say 000? I don't know what to say. I'd love to hear from British people and some instruction on how to read my credit card number.
Off the top of my head, I can't think of having ever heard triple, but I wouldn't rule it out. I don't actually know. Perhaps your commenters can let us know if they say triple.
Another example is what happens when you use numbers in the thousands or numbers with four digits. The president's address, that's called 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue in American. And I think most British people would be comfortable with that being 1600. But when you get to a bigger number, Americans are happy to say that is 5300. A British person would probably call this 5300. Yeah.
Where I grew up on downstate New York, pretty much everybody around me would say 5300. Like, for example, I know that my parents will say 5300. But for me as a kid, I always found that a confusing way to phrase that. There's something about it that just doesn't gel in my mind. And honestly, it took me years and years to really get that. And so in my mind, when I hear someone say something like 7200, I have to kind of think about it in terms of $100 bills. Right, so again, if someone says like 5300, I have to visualize 5300 bills on a table. For me, I always consciously made an effort to say 5300 instead of 5300.
Which do you think is more elegant, 5300 or 5300?
Well, 5300 is easier to understand. I mean, when I say 5300, I get confused myself whether I mean 5300 or 53,000.
Even though I think that 5300 is linguistically nicer, right? It sort of rolls off the tongue more easily. But I like the precision in saying 5,300. But I was definitely going against the tide of people that I lived around.
Nevertheless, I find it easy to say 50. When I'm thinking of numbers, when I want to say how much something cost.
You deal with $100 bills in America. Like, it's not rare to come across $100 bills, whereas I don't think there are, now I'm not 100% sure, but I don't think that there are 100-pound notes that are actually produced. I think it stops at 50. And I have only incredibly rarely in my life ever seen someone actually use a 50-pound note. And it's always remarkable. Like at a bank, I'll see someone pull out a 50. So maybe that's why, as an American, it's easier to think in terms of amounts of $100 bills, right? I have 12 $100 bills, so that's 1,200. I don't know if that has anything to do with it, but that might be why British people are not as comfortable with that kind of phrasing.
The second year of the 2000s was 2001 for in American speech generally. But in British speech, that sounds weird. That sounds American. You'd say 2001. So 2001, 2001.
This is one of those cases where, having lived in London for 10 years, and in particular having taught in front of classes and being very used to speaking to British people all the time, I can sometimes kind of forget these little phrases and which way have I always said it, and just naturally thinking about it, the 2001 or 2001, which way would I have said it when I was in New York? I'm not 100% sure. I think I would have said 2001, But it's one of those things that gets kind of lost when you move from one country to another. Sometimes those little things can just kind of, you just become uncertain about how it was. And then you feel like a crazy person, right? You feel like, I should know how I used to say things, but you just lose it. But I did look up, after you mentioned the 2001, I wanted to see how Arthur C. Clarke actually says that number.
Of course, 2001.
He is British, and he says in interviews, he says 2001 as the title for his book is the way he always phrased it. I tried to find some audio of Stanley Kubrick saying the title of the movie, but, you know, he's an incredibly secretive kind of guy and didn't do very many interviews about it. And so I was unable to find any clip of Stanley Kubrick actually speaking aloud the name of perhaps his most famous movie.
If you want to count out seconds, which people sometimes need to do, a typical way of doing this is to have a word that you put in between your numbers to make it long enough that you've got a full second between the two numbers. And the typical way to do this in American English, or atypical way to do it, is to use the word Mississippi. So one Mississippi, two Mississippi, three Mississippi.
Four Mississippi, five Mississippi, six Mississippi.
Hopefully it's about a second. I've never actually tested it.
I have no idea where it comes from, except that it's a fun word to say and it's long. So that seems like an obvious choice to go in the middle.
Another way to do it is one 1,000, two 1,000, which you'll notice has a different number of syllables. The one 1,000, two 1,000, I think is found in both America and Britain. But then in Britain, you've got other ones like one Piccadilly, two Piccadilly, three Piccadilly, or one elephant, two elephant, three elephant.
I was trying to think about this, and I don't think I've ever had the opportunity to hear any of my students count in this kind of way that you would do, where you're intentionally doing seconds. So I don't know what any of them would have said, but you asking me about this is basically the first time I've ever heard about Piccadilly or elephant.
When I said one Mississippi, two Mississippi, that's how I learned it, with that very specific sing-song kind of rhythm to help you count out the seconds. And because I've only done this on the blog, I've not actually heard people say one Piccadilly, two Piccadilly. I'm not quite sure how they're singing it.
Piccadilly, I think, is okay. It has that same kind of rhythm as Mississippi, right? So one Mississippi, two Piccadilly, three elephant. Like, elephant does not work. I don't think that works at all. I mean, one elephant, two elephant. It's so clunky. It's no good at all. I have to veto that one. But Piccadilly seems incredibly similar to Mississippi, so I'm perfectly happy with that as a difference.
But it's also the kind of thing that I've found people have family versions of that aren't used anywhere outside their extended family. So there's room for lots of variation.
We want to hear what word you put in between numbers when you count to make sure there's a second spacing. So put comments under the video. Mississippi, elephant, Piccadilly, thousand, something different. We want to know.
People often ask me or express astonishment when they get American addresses that they need to send something to, and the address might be four or five digit long, the number before the street. So, you know, to live at 2787 Main Street or something like that. Whereas, you know, the last place I lived here was number 7, and my mother always found that strange. She often wrote it as 70. She just couldn't imagine that I really lived at a place that was only number 7 in the great scheme of things.
It's funny because I never really tuned into the low house numbers thing. I mean, now that you have mentioned it, it seems incredibly obvious. And yes, I can think of a bunch of addresses in my life here that were low numbers. And it's definitely the case, well, at least it's the case in New York growing up, that I don't think there was ever a house number that was less than 100. So I knew people who lived in 100 or 107 or 109 houses. But I don't think there was ever a single address that was below that number.
Where I'm from, you never have a single digit. You rarely have a two-digit street address. So my family is on the first block of Miller Street, and the first number is 100. Well, it's about the grid road system in America. In England, you don't talk about blocks. the same way you do in America, because the roads are all higgledy-piggledy and don't necessarily make nice squares. But since American ones typically do make nice squares, what you want in this system is to have the numbers all match within each block. You talk about the 100 block of Miller Street. Once you cross the road that intersects with Miller Street and go on to the next block, it'll be the 200 block. So my block of my street where I grew up goes up to 131, and then it starts over at 200 once you cross the road.
So your numbers get higher quicker.
Yeah.
It is almost unbelievable to me that the numbers on one side of the street don't have anything to do with the numbers on the other side of the street. And I still come across this, and it's just appalling, right? That you're walking across the street, and the numbers on one side are going, you know, 3, 5, 7, 9. And you look across the other side of the street, and the numbers will be 50, 48, 46, right? They're even, they're not aligned, and they're going in the opposite direction. And it's just maddening. I don't understand how this came to be, why anybody has let it stand for as long as it has. It is just baffling to me. And the first few times that I ran across this, that I didn't realize, like, you have to check the numbers on the other side of the street, I got severely lost in London a couple of times trying to find places, because I'm walking down very long streets in the completely opposite direction, thinking, oh, I'll just cross the street when I need those even numbers, right? And then you get to wherever you're supposed to be, you cross the street, and you're hundreds off from wherever you were actually trying to get, but you're still on the same street. It's just unbelievable to me. I refuse to believe that humans ever decided to do this, right, on purpose. This isn't exactly number related, but I can tell you the thing that I did notice that I find is just charming is the habit of naming buildings houses, right? So even like a giant office building will sometimes have the name, and it'll be like 70 Darwin House. But this house suffix or this house label for like big corporate buildings or just council flats, I find is kind of remarkable and very charming in and of itself. And that strikes me as being very British, right? Where someone could say, you know, oh, I live at, you know, 50 Feynman House. And right, but 50 Feynman House is a gigantic tower block, right? It's not like a little cottage like it sounds. So I do quite like that. I love to explore the city and just kind of wander around, and there's always a ton of construction going on. And in particular, in the past few years and right now, there's a bunch of big luxury buildings going up or that have been recently constructed. And I can't help but notice that all of them want to be number one at whatever they are, right? So for example, there's one London Bridge, and there's one Blackfriars, there's one Tower Bridge, right? And these are luxury buildings. And they always write it like really big on the sign, right? It'll say one Blackfriars. And the other thing that I can't help but notice is they always like to write out the one, right? It's O-N-E. It's never the number one. I find that interesting. I assume that somewhere some architecture firm decided that this is a kind of luxury statement. I'd be curious to know if this happens elsewhere in the world, because, you know, as we discussed, I don't think that it can happen in New York, because the buildings can't start at one, right? They have to start at 100. But I've noticed that some of these buildings that label themselves as one whatever, they're in like suspicious spots where I look around and I think, I'm not sure that you can really claim that you are one Tower Bridge, right? There are numerous buildings here, any of which looks like they could be number one Tower Bridge. So I have my doubts about the accuracy of this number system. Although, you know, with the street numbers, you know, who knows, right? You know, the numbers don't have anything to do with anything, so they could just be all over the place.
So a man walks into a bar. He asks for 10 times more drinks than everyone else. The barman says, "Now that is an order of magnitude."